Hello everyone, welcome to Math Future event series. Today I am so happy to present people from Proof School. Now this is a really interesting, really out there, radical, I can say, education innovation. It just impresses me so much that people are out to make a school just like they want it. They really want to help the children who love mathematics very much. And they are pulling together an excellent team and excellent resources, a lot of experience. So today they are going to tell their story. Now, before we start, I just want us here to play a little game. So this is a mind of the world, and we can click next to the map. There are pointers, so click the little star or arrow and put it on the map where you are, or approximately where you are. This way we will know where people are, so we have East Coast, West Coast, we have an arrow appearing up north in the US. Here we are in different places, and this brings us together to talk about mathematics and children and the innovative school that Proof School is. And it's not there yet, but it will be. It's already here in the future, in the dream. So I'm going to present the Proof School now, and I'm really looking forward to hearing more all about it. Go ahead.
Well, thank you, Maria. This is Ian Brown, and welcome to everybody. I'm one of the co-founders of Proof School, along with Paul Zeitz, who's joining us on the call, and Dennis Leary, who's another parent. I'm a parent of a math kid, and I hope some of the people on the call today are also parents. And are interested. We're all interested in math education, and as Maria alluded to, we really identified a need and wanted to fill that need. And so today we're going to have a talk with Sam Vanderveld about math. We're going to have a talk with Zachary Cifuentes about humanities, and specifically humanities for kids who love mathematics. We have Kathy Lynn, our director of community outreach, on the line, who is going to be talking about how we're going to share what we're doing with the outside world and inviting the outside world into Proof School as a community hub. And then Paul Zeitz and I are going to talk a little bit about what our principles are, what our guiding axioms are, and what our schedule looks like going forward. And then we'll open it up to you to entertain some of your questions and your comments. We hope that most of our time will be spent doing just that, because I hope that you spent some time on our website. There's a lot of background information there, and at this stage, I'd like to turn it over to Paul and talk about who we are.
Hi, this is Paul Zeitz, and the project started about a year and a half ago. I was on sabbatical. And I do a lot of math circles all over the Bay Area, and I decided to start a math circle that was invitational, that just had a handful of really bright, engaged kids. One was Ian's son, another was Dennis's son, and we had a lot of fun just doing math at the pace we wanted to do math, and we did tremendous interesting things, and it was also a really wonderful social experience for the kids and for the parents. And we just started talking about why should this be just an hour a week? It really should be more, it should be what school is. And so we started to think, what if school could be like a math circle, or even better, what if school could be like a math camp? And that's sort of our log line, which is imagine high school, grad school, and math camp all rolled into one. And that's the idea of the school. And so logistically, it's a complicated idea, because we want to have a school that is an actual brick and mortar place that kids go to where they study all their subjects, but where the school is especially welcoming and is especially optimized for what we call math kids. So that's the type of project that we're trying to do. And the first order of business was to make sure that people didn't think we were crazy. And I got lots and lots of people who thought it was a good project. And most importantly, I got Sam Vanderbilt to agree to leave a tenured position at St. Lawrence University to come to be our mathematics dean and actually build the curriculum. So you have a sense this is a school, but it's a school for math kids, and I think we all know at least basically what's meant by that. But there's a lot of possible models of a school. So what I just want to take you through is sort of our guiding principles for how we'd like our school to distinguish itself. And as the school evolves, these principles will really help to guide us. We have just six little axioms. The first one is just a statement of identity. We're a full-fledged school for kids who love math. And then we have sort of an organizational directive, which is to not waste time and to travel light, not to waste our students' time and not to waste money, to be as efficient as possible. And then our axioms get a little more philosophical. It's what is our educational philosophy? So of course we love math, but we really want to remind people, and especially our students, that math is not just an intellectual pursuit. It's a social endeavor. We also would like our school to be something where learning is not something done in a vacuum, but something done with engagement with the physical world. And it also should be fun. It should be more like play. And we also want to make sure that the students that we're educating grow up to understand their place in the world and to be good people and not to worship the mere intelligence that they have. That's merely an attribute. It's not a virtue. And then last but not least, is our perhaps our biggest goal for the school, which is not to just be a school, but to be a really important part of the intellectual community, essentially in the world. And the outreach part of Proof School potentially could be the most important part of the project. So I'd like to see if Ian wants to add anything to that.
Yeah, I think that you've hit the nails on the head, as it were. We are coming out of a tradition of Russian and middle European mathematics traditions, which have morphed into math circles around the country here, and many have said that we're the next iteration of that trend. And by taking this humanities and social emotional learning and music and foreign language and all of the other parts of a school that are so important for having a happy whole person, but devoting as much time to mathematical sciences as we're planning to do, has really resonated with the larger community. And frankly, much more so than I ever imagined when Paul and I first hatched this plan going on almost 2 years. You're all here listening because you have a vested interest and some yearning for this sort of school to happen. And we're very busy turning this dream into a reality. But again, it all comes down to recognizing a need in kids. I'll just go back to Paul's invitational math circle with half a dozen kids. I'd never seen these kids happier. And I, as a parent, and I'm sure there are other parents listening who've done the same thing, have put together a program for their own children over and over again and driving them around. I know I'm a big chauffeur. I drive all over the place to get mathematics in front of my son. And I just turned to Dennis Leary, our the other parent who's a co-founder, and said, you know, this should be happening every single day. Look at them. They're so happy. And that has resonated. I think our mission is very clear. I think our vision is very clear. We're certainly turning that vision into something really tangible. And that's the exciting part about it all right now.
So let me move on a little bit. So we gave a very brief overview of our philosophy, but in the end, the devil's in the details. And so the next two slides are just sort of a quick overview of how we actually want to organize education in the school. We're going to use a block plan, and it'll be an unusual block plan. We'll have 5-6 week periods for much of the curriculum. And we'll have just one topic going on at different levels simultaneously. And in between the blocks will be builds, where we will be using field trips and also actually building things. One aspect of the school that I think is very important is to bring back old-fashioned building things, not just a shop, but 21st century shop. And learn again, this is part of our philosophy of engaging with the physical world. And then part of our community axiom is to end the year always with sharing projects with the wider community, and that will happen ongoing as well. Now, there we go. So now, one more slide. The idea of the year, again, we have five blocks with the six builds in between. So we start with a build and ending with our demo. That's what each year will be like. And as the years go on, we'll have a sort of a spiral education. But I want to turn this over now to the people who are actually going to be doing the work at the school, such as Sam and Zachary and Kathy.
There we go. Hello, I'm Sam Vanderveld, and I'll try to give a brief but comprehensive introduction of myself in a second, but I feel that to begin, I'm going to scoot forward. I'm going to let you see the most complicated slide here. You might need a few minutes to study that. There will be a quiz in a second, so be ready. But the message, the very first thing that I want to say, because I feel it's one of the most important things I can say, is to talk once again about who the school is for. Because this is a school for kids who love math. And I can imagine a family or a student saying to themselves, gosh, I love math, but you know, I'm not scoring high on these math contests. And I love math. I would spend 2 or 3 hours in the afternoon and you know, and sometimes do when I get a chance, playing around with little ideas. I don't feel like I'm very advanced. And I want that kid to know that this school is for her and for him, and that we welcome you, that we have all sorts of wonderful material for you, that this is your place. And I imagine that many of you that are listening right now or listening to the recording may not be in that position or be that family, but you may well know a person who is in that position. And when they ask you about the school, please relay that message for me, that this is a school for kids who love math, and that we want to have a broad spectrum, kids who love contests, kids who love just delving into research problems and so forth. But I did promise an introduction. So I'm coming from a lot of directions, and they're relevant to what the experience is going to be like for the kids at the school. I'm currently the chair of the math department at St. Lawrence University, and I've taught there for 8 years. And during that time, I've come to really appreciate the importance of engaging students in research. And my students, by far the best part of their 4 years there, they tell me this is the semester we spend on an individual research project doing something they're interested in. They walk through the whole process of inquiry and conjecture and coming up with results and writing a paper and presenting, and to have them participate in the the mathematical scholarship in that way is an eye-opening experience for them, and it's one of the most satisfying parts of their 4 years at the school and mine as well. I'm also very involved with MathPath. This is a summer residential program for middle school students. So I work with a lot of different age groups. The students that I see in the summer, I spend 4 solid weeks with, all 24 hours a day, literally. And we're doing math all the time. We talk about math in the halls. I was working with a kid over breakfast about why a particular set of coordinates form the vertices of a regular dodecahedron in space. That's the kind of thing that happens in MathPath. I've been very involved with math circles, of course, over the years. In particular, initiated and launched the Stanford Math Circle, and the sort of topics that arise in a math circle setting and the style of engagement with kids has very much influenced the way that I see having the classroom time being spent at Proof School. I've also taught at an independent school for 5 years. I taught at the Roxbury Latin School, which is an excellent boys school in the Boston area. And that's informed a great deal of who I am as well. Everything from admissions to the importance of students being active during the day to where my classroom style was really born. And then on the side, I run the Mandelbrot competition and engage kids at the high school level across the country in mathematical problem solving that way. And then, of course, I'm a math kid myself and was on the IMO team in my senior year and so forth. So I'm drawing on all of these different aspects of my own background, and I'm going to weave them into this school. I want to engage kids in a marvelous mathematical experience that in which they're helping me to write problems for the Mandelbrot competition, in which they're working on research projects with me that will get typed up in the LaTeX, the mathematical typesetting software, and published in our own journal. I do this with my classes at St. Lawrence. And so I'm drawing all these as I come into the looking forward to the vision for our students at Proof School. And I'm going to skip back now to, as Paul said, that's a wonderful vision to have, but it takes an intelligent framework in which to make it happen. And I believe we've found such a framework, and I can't wait to put this into action. So we begin with a solid 2.5 hours devoted to mathematics each afternoon, and this gives us the number of contact hours with kids to go through the equivalent of a college level course in a 6-week time frame. So we'll spend that much time on introductory problem solving or that much time on graph theory. It's going to allow us to go far with it. And the time, I was thinking, that might feel to many people like a very a very long time, but the time will fly because the teaching style is engaging. My kids are going to help me to make up definitions. They're going to fill in the details in my examples. Then we're going to split up and work on problems in groups and then have people present them. And then there'll be a video clip to see related to turning a sphere inside out. And then there'll be individual work time to just grapple, sort of the equivalent of homework time, where they'll grapple with problems individually, maybe pair up and compare. The class time will be varied throughout, and we'll move right along. So let me skip forward. You remember I promised a quiz. Well, here it is. So during the year, we'll visit 5 broad categories of sort of within mathematics, and if you can remember what those 5 are, then you get a perfect score on the quiz. We'll start with problem solving and combinatorics, which encompasses a whole variety of classes. The same for those other 4 broad topics, that's algebra and number systems. By number system, I'm including things not only complex numbers, but we'll take a look at finite fields and we'll play with group theory and so forth. And then in the middle of the year, we have geometry and topology. Moving on next, we have analysis and statistics. And then finally, we finish the year with number theory and computer science, which one person asked, why do those two go together? And the answer is that students actually get to choose, to some extent, the course they'll take. During those build weeks in between the blocks, that's when the student advising takes place. And students who want to spend time programming will use that fifth block for programming classes. Others will choose to do number theory. In that way, we can give every kid a little bit of what they want. The other thing I want to point out is that this allows students, after they finish a few core courses, they're going to be grouped largely by interest, as opposed to some sort of strict sequential hierarchy of courses where the smart kids, sort of in quotes, are always taking a higher level course. The courses will be broad and run in parallel, so that kids will spread out by interest and be grouped that way, as opposed to in sort of a more of a tracking, traditional tracking kind of setup. And what a diverse offering it's going to be when we're running when the school is at 200 students or so, or more, then there'll be so many courses going on at once. There'll be 12 math teachers. They'll all be teaching, during the first 6 weeks, they're all going to be teaching something related to problem solving or combinatorics. But of course, that means that someone will be doing generating functions, and somebody will be doing partition theory, and somebody will be doing Olympiad problem solving, and I'll be running a class on writing Mandelbrot problems, and we'll produce the contest for the. All these things are going on at once. Students each year get to choose one of them during those first 6 weeks. And if in day two a student discovers that that's not quite right for them, then they just walk next door to the course that perhaps turns out to be a better fit. This is what we gain, and this is in keeping with our axiom of not wasting time. That the students are always in a course that they're interested in, and it's at the right level for them. Let's wrap this up. I'll say, we've touched on a lot of this. The only thing that I'll add at this point is that of course it's crucial to have teachers who are mathematicians. To give a mathematical experience, it's necessary to have participated in a mathematical experience yourself. And in all aspects, in research, in just playing around, in just an inquiring mind that's ready to share with students. So I have a marvelous plan for teachers as well that will help keep them fresh and active and working on projects with kids. But I won't go into that detail at this point. Let's just finish with this one more time. And again, you can see within, sorry if you squint a little bit, you can see some of the different courses that I anticipate being offered within each block. These are meant to be exemplary and not quite exhaustive. And of course, at the start, we won't offer every single one at a time. And then at the end, we'll be offering more than you see there. So I'm sure I've talked for too long already, but that gives you just a hint of what I hope to do with students at Proof School. And I will move things along to the other half, and I truly mean in a equally balanced way, the other half of the picture here.
Hi, everybody. This is Zacharias E. Fuentes, and I will be the Dean of Humanities at Proof School, or the other title that I have is the NOMAD, the non-math academic dean. And very much like I have been doing ever since I joined this project, I am really going to follow Sam's lead here, and I want to jump you straight down to an overview slide of what the humanities are going to look like so that you can be looking at that while I introduce myself just a bit to you. So let me go ahead and jump forward very briefly. So here we have the block plan for the humanities, and just while you're looking at this, I wanted to tell you a little bit about myself. I teach at Stanford right now. I'm in the program in Writing and Rhetoric, and I teach first-year writing courses. I also teach a second-year oral communication course, the Oral Communication of Research. And prior to Stanford, I was at Harvard as well in their writing program, where I was a head preceptor, so I had some more curricular responsibilities there in addition to teaching. And Harvard is where I really got my start. And it's really where I got to define myself as a scholar and as a teacher. And in some sense, it's where I found who I was as a professional and as a person. I went there as an undergrad long ago. But what I wanted to share with you there was a little bit about my story of what I've done at Harvard as a way to tell you what I'm going to bring to Proof School. And so early on in my time at Harvard, I had a student come up to me and was very frustrated and said that he wasn't feeling like he was learning enough about writing in my writing course. And now you can imagine that was tough to hear. But what he said was that he wasn't sure that I was teaching him how to write a paper in government or poli-sci. And so I decided to backtrack a little bit, and I reconfigured a project for the very next class, which was students were bringing in writing prompts and writing assignments and written work for other classes into our writing class, and we were going to workshop that, and we were going to work with that. And so from the beginning, what I've been thinking about very much is are the ways in which writing and at large communicating really cut across the disciplines. And fast forward a few years at Harvard, I've since worked on a number of projects at the curricular level at Harvard that try to connect departments together, disciplines together through writing and later through speaking. And so what you are seeing here in this block plan is a overview of the ways in which I was able to bring a writerly awareness and communications, awareness of communication to departments like government, religion, literature, but even in some of the sciences. And what we found out was that we can actually really connect quite a bit together this way. At Harvard, I also discovered a little bit about my interest in art making. And I became a letterpress printer at Harvard and ran a letterpress studio in the basement of an undergrad dorm, where I was also a dorm parent for 6 years, 5 years. And these two experiences really sort of form my approach to the humanities at Proof School. So on the one hand, you have a very transferable skills in speaking, writing, researching, and on the other hand, in making and building and creating things. And so let me take you back a little bit, looking at humanities at Proof School. And here we have this first slide here is about our unique connections. And what I'm most focused on is less on controlling the specifics that students will be learning, and I'm more interested in providing a framework for that learning to happen. And so creating connections this way will be based largely on writing and speaking in across the humanities. And what I really want to be able to do is to really rely on the what I'll call the local expertise in the subject matters that my faculty will be bringing here. So I don't want to tread on anybody's fields of expertise in the realm of, say, history, and tell them that these are the things that history needs to be taught within history. I'm going to trust my faculty to really bring their interest, their love, the things that drew them to their fields. I want them to bring that to Proof School. And so what I'm trying to create here is a learning curriculum, a curriculum for speaking, for writing, for sharing what it is that we like. And so here, roughly speaking, we will have a middle school and a high school, roughly speaking. And I like to think about this as a gradient where the middle school will be a little bit more focused on making and creating, tinkering, and the high school will be a little bit more focused on a more conventional sense of scholarship or of academics. But these will bleed through each other quite a bit. But what I really want to emphasize is that I think that sometimes when, if you look at some of our profiles here, you know, we're coming from these colleges, we're coming from these high octane universities, like Stanford and Harvard, and I don't want students or parents to feel that what we're going to be doing is imposing some sense that they need to be grown up in that kind of awful way. And what I want you to know is that if you like Legos, if you like blocks, if you like sandcastles, you are going to love Proof School. And I have on order so many projects that I would love to see us enact and that will enact our learning as much as possible. But we are going, as Paul said earlier, learning is fun. And the number of times that I have had conversations with my freshmen and my sophomores at the college level, when they're starting to see that beautiful patina of these awesome universities are starting to wear thin, I think that what they've oftentimes have lost a sense of is that they got to these places because they loved learning, because they had so much fun learning. And at some point, and everybody will experience this, but at some point, you know, they start to experience it more as just a job or just something that they're doing. And I want to put the fun back in learning. I want to make sure that it's there from day one. And so for anybody out there who might be thinking, like, to what level, how intense this is going to be, it's going to be fun more than it's going to be intense. And that is one big goal that I have. And so once we transition to high school, like I said, we're going to transition a little bit more into a more sort of narrowly defined academic culture. It's still going to be fun. We're still going to be building things. We're still going to be making things. But what I want to do is to take students through four semesters of college level instruction in writing, presenting, and publishing. And in some sense, where the math curriculum is going to be doing a whole lot of math in any one year, we're going to be doing a whole lot of writing and presenting, but we're going to really stretch this out. So a semester, instead of cramming a bunch of work into just one semester that you'll normally get at colleges, we're going to take a whole year to get there. We're going to take it slow, and we're going to build it up. And just like Sam was saying, a lot of my own teaching involves quite a bit of doing and making and talking in class. So our classes will be a little bit longer than a normal, say, 45-minute class or 50-minute class. You know, we want to stretch that time period because I want to be right there with those students as they're discovering things and making things and thinking about things and asking them to turn around and discuss this with somebody else or to go ahead and write that introduction right now. That's what I want them to be doing right there in front of me. And then lastly, just as a way to sort of transition this a little bit over to Kathy, who will be talking about our outreach, I wanted to touch a little bit on our plan for social-emotional learning. And I think that it's a fairly new concept, but I think that a lot of parents, this will come really natural to you. And the sense there is awareness of self and awareness of others, to empathize with others, but also to be really generous with yourself so that, you know, like if you didn't do so well on that one problem set, you know, don't beat yourself up over it. That learning is tough, but it's really fun too. And so we want to learn generosity toward each other and toward ourselves. And we can do this a number of ways. And one of them is that we're developing a Proof School seminar right now that will be for eighth graders. What we're thinking for eighth graders that will, you can almost think about it as life seminars. And so when I was at Harvard, a really good friend of mine ran a bunch of life seminars in the undergrad dorms, and this will be loosely modeled on that, but where we're learning how to fix things, how to do things, how to think through things, we're reflecting on how we're feeling about what we're learning as a way to internalize this entire amazing experience that Proof School is giving us. But the other thing I wanted to say with this, very briefly before we move it over to Kathy, is that I think there's another way to think about social-emotional learning as a way to tie it into what we're learning, academics itself. And so in this sense, my view of the humanities is that the humanities are really the disciplines where we learn to empathize with others, that reading a novel, that reading a novel can really position us in that perspective of that narrator. And so in that sense, being very careful in curating what it is that we have students read and what it is that we have them study to reinforce this awareness of self and awareness of others is going to be key in my own planning. I want my students to be able to not just study history as if it were some abstract thing in the past, but to really see it through a personal lens. And I don't just mean their own personal lens. I mean from the people who have experienced history. And I think that literature can do this really beautifully for us. And so looking for these really transformative texts, these transformative novels, will be something that I'm going to be working with my faculty and developing. But the idea here is that social-emotional learning isn't just something that happens within the field of psychology. It really happens in the field of humanities. It'll happen in the field of mathematics. It'll happen in the field of the sciences. That learning from one another and finding out those tools that are necessary for happiness with ourselves and who we are is going to be so critical to what we're doing. And with that, thank you so much for listening. And this is a project that I'm not only excited to be a part of, but is something I'm incredibly proud to be a part of. And I can't wait to meet all of you in person and to work with your children and to work with you kids who are listening right now with this. So with that, Kathy, please, will you take it over?
Hi, so this is Kathy. Hello from Boston. So actually, I haven't figured out the slides, so Zachary, if you don't mind advancing the slides for me, that would be a big help. So I guess I'll just say a word about myself. When I was one of those kids who went to math camp and wished that, you know, school could be like that. I went to the Ross program for a number of years when I was in high school. And then I went to MIT, studied math. I've taught high school math. I'm working on a dissertation about basically about math kids. And for the past several years, I've been working at MIT doing various things in open online education. So I'm delighted to join Proof School as the Director of Community Outreach. And I guess I'll also add that my husband is a mathematician, and we have two little math kids of our own, so it's sort of a very personal cause to me as well. So anyway, I'll say a few words about community outreach. The broader community, I think, is absolutely core to Proof School in the way we develop it, in the way we run the school. So our approach to community outreach, I think, centers on these four actions here: learn, collaborate, share, and serve. I think in many respects, Proof School is building upon the great work of a lot of really dedicated people who have been trying to serve kids who love math. You know, so a number of us have benefited from these programs ourselves, and we're really lucky to have a lot of these leaders on our team, and many, many more educators, parents, students, and math enthusiasts from around the world sort of chiming in, and we fully embrace that, you know, there's a lot for us to learn from other people, from the hard work that people have been doing, and we think that these conversations we've been having, the potential collaborations we have had, will really help us do the best that we can for the kids who come to Proof School. And also, we feel strongly compelled to collaborate and share and serve because we recognize that there are many, many kids who love math who will not be at Proof School, and that there are many educators out there who are working hard to nurture those kids. So we think that Proof School will be an incredible school for our kids, but for us, this work is not only about our own kids, but about all kids who love math. So, you know, we're not territorial about our work at all. You know, we want to share as much as we can, and we want to sort of contribute to the broader cause of helping math kids thrive. So on the next slide, I guess there's the question of what will we do in community outreach? One key aspect of how we'll approach outreach is that we will be open. We will share our curriculum, our materials, our pedagogy, you know, all the things that we can share openly, we will. As you heard from Sam and Zachary, we'll have sort of a world-class, you know, and rather unusual curriculum, and we would be delighted if other people could, you know, use it or adapt it in whatever way suits, you know, their purposes. In the same spirit, we've begun to share our ideas and our work online. So if you visit our website, we've been sharing some of our ideas on our blog, and we will continue to make a very deliberate and ongoing effort to describe what we're doing, what we're thinking about, what we've learned. And it's not to say that, you know, we think that this is the one way to do things, but we've heard from lots of people that they're interested in sort of having a window into proof school. And, you know, we think that our work will be worth sharing. So we'd like to make it available. So the next slide, visits and visitors. So we're very interested in interacting with other people. So we're eager to welcome visitors to proof school. We think that, you know, there's a lot to be gained from sort of seeing things in person, and there's a lot for us and our students to gain from having a range of visitors as well. And, you know, we also think that for us, the adults as well as the students, that, you know, visiting other places and other people, seeing other schools, going to conferences, those are all extremely enriching experiences for us to learn and for us to share what we're doing. And we plan to have lots and lots of conversations, lots and lots of collaborations. We want to sort of actively participate in and stimulate conversations about how to best serve math kids. And then my last slide, so going back to the social emotional learning that Zachary mentioned earlier, we think that service is a critical experience for our students. So we'd like them to be very active in interacting with the broader community. We think that there are a lot of opportunities for them to participate in service learning in a way that's meaningful to them and to the local communities. So, for example, our students could be leading weekly math circles for local kids or developing museum exhibits, creating videos, you know, showcasing the math, not only sort of the concept, but what makes it really exciting to them. We think that, you know, our kids will have a deep understanding of what it's like to be a math kid, and, you know, hopefully they'll be really well equipped to help other kids who are like them, especially, you know, kids who are perhaps a few years younger. So this will tie into, I think, their academic education as well as the social emotional piece that Zachary touched upon. And then so I guess the last thing I'll mention is just programs. So most of the things, sort of the idea of sharing open resources is more about helping other people do the best that they can in their programs. We would love to interact directly with people as well. And so, you know, you could imagine a lecture series with discussions about math, or discussions about math, discussions about gifted kids, social emotional learning. We might have workshops on mathematical art or professional development workshops for teachers and so on. And so we see a lot of this happening in the Bay Area, sort of building up our local community, but also we're also thinking sort of national, especially given how far you can reach and how much you can do online these days. So I think that's it for me.
This is Ian again. We have a lot coming up in the next few months. In this month, we have a lot coming up. We have a series of on-site previews, similar to what we're doing today, but at Stanford and at UC Berkeley and USF and Dominican University in San Rafael. And a couple of events coming up as well, one with Art Benjamin in October, and another one where we're doing some puzzles and games and online games with Zynga, the games maker in San Francisco. We have so many things that we're working on simultaneously, and I hope you've got a really good sense of who's on board, what they're up to, what we're trying to pull together. There are a lot of strings out there that we're trying to knit together into a school, and it's very hard work. We've gotten some great suggestions from people we've talked to, and you know, at this time, I think I'd like to turn it over to you to ask some questions, if that's a good time to do that.
Thank you so much for all the stories. What a team, what a concept. It's just so incredible what thought went into it and how everything is now coming together. There were several questions in the chat, which some of them were also answered in the chat, but I'd like to summarize some of them or come to them. So I'll do that for the next few minutes, and people can keep typing questions in the chat. Quite a few people asked questions about different types of outreach, basically how can people play with you if they are not in San Francisco or if they're not in the school. So it looks like you give a lot of thought to the outreach, and it looks like the community will help you in that. So in particular, one question you haven't addressed yet, it came up at the very beginning about mathematical circles in Africa and researchers doing mathematical circles in different countries. Do you have particular plans for international interest for working with mathematicians from all over the world, math kids from all over the world? Can someone talk about it?
So I think I can say something about this. We've been in touch with actually a number of people from around the world, including two different groups in Africa who are interested in creating very similar things in Africa, and we would be excited to potentially work with them as our school develops. So I think we're happy to do what we can to foster great experiences for math kids anywhere in the world. And we will be trying to develop collaborations with people where we can. And one possibility is to have some sort of sister school program where we would have to figure out the details of how to collaborate. But, we could work together in developing curriculum. We could potentially have an exchange program. All sorts of things like that are on the table.
I think the next question, I'll do the outreach questions again. Will you do things online, or will it mostly be face-to-face events and programs? And I'll ask a more general question. How can people who want to help or volunteer or offer programs and connections play with you and get together with you or offer what they have? What is a good way to reach out to you? So two questions together, and most of these people, of course, will be reaching to you online. So what about that, Kathy?
Sure. So the question of will we be doing things online, the answer is absolutely yes. But there are a range of things that can be done online. So I think, beginning from year one, we will certainly be sharing materials and sharing ideas online. If you're thinking of sort of more active programs, such as, like online courses and things like that, I think it's on the table, but we don't have concrete plans in that direction yet. If people are interested in sharing, we are delighted to hear from you. You can email me at klynn@proofschool.org. I would be happy to talk to you. I think at this stage, we're still very much in development, so in many regards, we are collecting ideas more than anything else, but it would be great to hear from anyone who's interested.
Thank you.
One thing this is, again, just a vague answer, but you can think of sort of the outreach world in a spectrum, and at one end of the spectrum is the Museum of Math in New York City. And then perhaps at the other end of the spectrum is the Moscow Center for Continuous Mathematical Education in Moscow, of course. And they are very, very different organizations. I'm sure most people know about the Museum of Math, but somewhat fewer know about the Moscow Center for Continuous Mathematical Education. But I hope that Proof School ends up somewhere in the middle. That it'll be a place for people to physically visit where there'll be physical things going on, there'll be art, there'll be lectures, there'll be things of that sort, but it also will be a place where there will be classes emanating from the school, not just physically, but online, and there'll be publications at some point. And the more important thing is that it will be in San Francisco, and it'll be an intellectual center. It'll be something new that the city of San Francisco hasn't had, and it will grow naturally.
Thank you.
If I could add to that, one area of the website that people can collaborate with us online and inform us about ideas that they have and resources they know of and research they've done. We're going to be launching very soon, it's actually live right now in a demo, our forums page, whereby people can start topics just like a regular forum that everyone's familiar with and get responses. And we're going to be looking at those, and we're going to be asking people to point things out to us that could be interesting. There could be threads about math education. There could be threads about humanities education, social-emotional learning, different resources for kids who can't participate in San Francisco with Proof School but want to have a hand in math education and growing as mathematicians, young mathematicians. So, we'll be launching that outside of beta in the next few days, and we really encourage people to leave something of themselves there to help us grow, because we don't have all the answers. We're learning as we go. We have a great team, as you've heard, and some great ideas, but we don't have a monopoly on those, and we'd love to hear more. So online participation, the best place to do that is in the forums that are coming up this week.
Great to hear all that. It really is. So Miranda had a question for Zachary about different experiences of different people, even more different in humanities maybe, and you are trying to attract diverse students. So how are you going to reconcile all this highly individualized education and a lot of student choice which you want to support, and at the same time doing things somewhat together in group settings?
Hi, everybody. Yep, that was a great question that I saw in there. And I'll tell you, the way that I've been able to do this in the past was actually really informed by something of a trial by fire, and it was actually at Harvard. It was in my first semester of teaching at Harvard, and I was by no means new to teaching writing at the college level, but it was my first time teaching at the level of, say, a Harvard. And what I noticed in teaching there, that prior, all of my experiences, the range of students that I had, there was a range of students, but it was a fairly narrow range. And so you can imagine that, students who are going to, say, a community college, which I've taught at, will have a vast range of experiences, versus the University of Miami, where I taught, had a very different array of experiences, and even the University of Michigan. Now, when I got to Harvard, an amazing thing happened. I had one student on the second week of class turn in a 15-page, multi-source, researched paper, and who was writing beautifully and was thinking incredibly. And in the same class, I had a student who was really struggling to hold together paragraphs. And what was interesting to me was it was really a function of the mission of a place like Harvard. And I've had the same experience at Stanford. And it's because these schools have a mission of going out and finding the best students at the best schools and the best students at the non-best schools, so even schools that are really struggling. So I had experience with this. And so to answer the question a little more directly, how do I sort of make room for that range of abilities and experiences and talents within the humanities? And I've really worked hard to create a curriculum that allows everybody to be challenged at whatever level they're at. So we could all be reading the same poem or the same book together, but the way in which we are approaching that book or that poem in a paper, in a research paper, in a discussion, might be different based on our own experiences and abilities. And there's nothing that I've seen that just enlightens my day more than when I see my students come in that very first week of class and they're nervous about writing because they've never, quote unquote, been a writer. And they leave the class feeling confident that they can learn writing. It's not going to mean that they learn writing in one semester. That's something that we don't aim to do, right? It's to teach them everything they need to know in just 10 weeks or 14 weeks. But the point is that we can really help everybody get to some next level that they're aiming for. I had a mentor early on who told me, You know, your job is not to move students from point A to point B. Your job is to move students from point A in the direction of B. And that means that there's a range of possibilities for students to experience there. And, you know, sometimes students are going to stumble, they're going to be challenged, and other times they're really going to soar. And my job is to remain as flexible as possible in that. Now, in the humanities, we won't have as many levels of classes that math will be having, but we will be absolutely recognizing everybody's individual level, and so we'll do a lot of one-on-one conferences. I am designing a curriculum right now that will create time for faculty to have one-on-one conferences. I think that is so essential in learning. And so a half-hour conference during every block is the equivalent of 2 or 3 weeks of class time. And so this is how we're really going to personalize that education.
Thank you. I want to say that we say that will be an hour, and I want to say to our moderators, to our presenters, that an hour is almost up. But if you have time and inclination to answer a few more questions, we can continue staying here. I don't want to keep you because we said that's the time. But if you do have time. People had a few more questions, so whoever can stay, please do. So let's continue then. Go ahead, Ian.
Oh, I certainly have time. I'm sorry, I'm in the chat room, busy chatting away. What was your request? What did you ask for?
You turned your microphone on, so I thought you were talking, but I have a next question ready. And that question is actually about something quite a few people here said about students choosing things, choosing this or that, their curriculum, their activities. There are such things as free schools, like Sudbury Valley model, where students choose absolutely everything, their mentors, their activities, 100% of everything they do. And then there are places where students choose nothing whatsoever. They are told everything and follow what they are told. So where are you in between there? What is your mix here of what students will choose, what students will not choose?
This is Sam, and I can say a little bit towards that. It's true. I recall saying students would choose what course they'll take in the next block and so forth. The process, in my mind, the process is going to be something of a group effort with the teachers and the students taking a look at, say, we've got the geometry block coming up, and we have to sort ourselves into, you know, suppose that we have 60 students currently and five teachers. So we have to sort ourselves into five groups. And each group has to be led by a teacher who is, you know, competent and excited about a particular subject. So, for instance, spherical trigonometry is not quite as much of a specialty for me as projective geometry. So I would choose the latter. And we'll settle on a selection of courses for that particular year in geometry, which would probably include in a very intro level Euclidean level geometry. Perhaps it's time for a solid geometry course. Perhaps it's the right time to offer a spherical trigonometry course, maybe an Olympiad level geometry course, and maybe there's a group of kids who have been begging for topology for a few years. And so we put together this selection of classes, and we do so in a way that guarantees that we're going to have roughly equal class size, so that or maybe we offer two sections of the intro level geometry. It all depends on who the students are. And then we run with it for our 6 weeks. Then the next year, of course, we have geometry again.
And the next year, there's still an intro level, but this time we're going to do hyperbolic geometry, and we're going to do another topology because there's another group of kids who heard about how fun it was last time. And it's a little bit more fluid. It's influenced, obviously, by a college style of offering courses where there's a lot of flexibility. But that gives you a little bit of a sense of what goes into it. There's a wide variety of courses that we advertise, and then there's a subset of them that actually occur each year within a particular block.
Thank you. This looks like an interesting hybrid between an unconference college and free school, a bit of everything together. So will be very interesting to see how that emerges, because of course we need better models now that we have more experience with different things. So I have a question about your curriculum design. So you shared these beautiful diagrams that you use, very visual design diagrams. So of course you probably won't be designing everything from scratch, but it looks like you are really putting a lot of effort in curriculum design in particular. So that's tremendous work, and people spend years just designing curriculum, designing standards for it. So do you see Proof School as a thought leader on curriculum design? What are your ideas there?
Sam, can you speak to that? There you are.
I can. I'll take that question as directed to me. And I'll say two things. The first is the goal of developing an entire curriculum from scratch is monumental, and it simply isn't going to happen all at once. So we're going to have to be smart about how we gradually grow the in-house part of our curriculum. I anticipate starting with the lower level classes and bringing the philosophy that I see, kind of bringing a mathematical experience to kids as an overarching principle. At the same time, I'll say that we do. It's almost of necessity, we'll need to at the very least adapt and in most cases wholesale create our curriculum in-house, because we have a unique kind of class format with a 2.5 hour class time and just a 6 week window in which to present something. So, why don't I leave it at that and let anyone else chime in as well.
I'll go ahead and add something. I just put it on the chat. In terms of designing the curriculum, the curriculum that I'm designing for the humanities really is leaning on the curriculum that I have been involved in creating at Harvard and at Stanford and enacting at Stanford. And I'm adapting that to Proof School, and I've been working actually really intentionally with our math team, with Sam, in explaining, okay, I explained to him, this is what I have taught in the past, this is what we focused on, this is how I've taught this is how I approach this topic, and he's been helping me make some adaptations and translations into a more mathematical language, if you will. But I was really surprised as well to see just how many overlaps there are between the kind of ways of writing and thinking and doing in the humanities and the ways of thinking and making in math. And so, for instance, Sam and I had a great conversation along with Ian at one point about problem writing, about the idea that in math, kids oftentimes will do a lot of writing of problems. And in the humanities, this happens all the time. It happens all the time where instead of saying describing what a book is about, researchers and scholars in the humanities will describe the way a book can be misread or misunderstood. Or there's a pattern in this book that seems to be broken, and they'll focus on that broken moment that breaks the pattern. And so problem writing will be actually really critical in the humanities, the sense that the humanities are founded on questions and gaps and problems. Now, these are fundamentally very different problems, yes, but I was really surprised, and it was really exciting to see just how many connections there are between the humanities and math, in a sense. And so a lot of what you're seeing on this current page is something that is actually really derived from the Harvard and Stanford writing programs, with some adaptation there. But these are things that we think about intensely in the humanities and in writing. These five blocks are things that we consider very much. And a lot of this has a lot to do with the math side as well.
I'd like to just piggyback on that as well. I've taught middle school language arts and fourth and fifth grade mathematics, and would ditto that statement unequivocally. Largely our program is inquiry based, and that means working with all students to understand what it means to ask great questions and to get frustrated by not finding answers immediately, and being able to pivot and turn and ask more questions, and then analyzing the research that you've been delving deeply into, and then synthesizing it, thinking about it deeply, synthesizing it, pulling it back together, and communicating something to a broader audience. And so what Zachary has built here is really, really a tangible outcome of that idea of inquiry-based learning, which is a great way to learn, I think. I've done it myself. I've seen it in action. I've seen kids really come alive with that empowering type of learning. And as Zachary said earlier, his emphasis is on learning and not necessarily on teaching, which often teachers spend a lot of time trying to figure out. So it is a work in progress. We are going to be building a lot of it in-house, but a lot of it we're going to be informed by best practices that are out there, and we're open to suggestions as well.
Sounds like you almost have a constantly emerging curriculum, something that happens every week, every month, as children and students and teachers together reinvent their learning, but it's based on the principles and scaffolding that some of which you are demonstrating now at this diagram. There is let's take a couple more questions. There is a question in chat from Saul about the school name, and let's back to you, Ian, here. Why Proof School? What's in the name? And your talk button is off. I think it's a question for Ian.
Oh, hi there. Sorry. That's an interesting question. I am a teacher by training, a journalist by accident, and an entrepreneur by nature, and all of those parts of me combined with some really great people to create this school. And the name came about because I partly wanted to prove that it could be done. Again, I saw my own son growing up, and he loves mathematics more than anything else, and he was not finding people often that he could share that love with. And I imagined, I'm not a mathematician by training, And so I spent a lot of time reading about mathematicians and mathematical thinking and problem solving and open problems and millennium problems. And I came away from reading biographies oftentimes hearing from mathematicians who felt like their high school years were wasted years, they were not interesting, they didn't have people they connected with, they were working in a vacuum. And I thought, you know, that's not really what I want for my own son. And I see him with his friends really enjoying working together. Why, again, why not make this a full-time endeavor? And at the heart of it, I'm a writer by training, and proofs are all about writing mathematics and communicating mathematics to those who understand the lingo, as it were. It's not necessarily for a broader audience like someone like Ian Stewart would be writing as a math popularizer or Keith Devlin, but it is writing for the converted, and I wanted to really emphasize that idea of communicating the love of mathematics outwards by doing it together as a group. It also, I'm a bit of a branding maven, if you will. I love branding and marketing, and it really looked good as a name. It looked good as a URL, you know, 00000. It just spoke to me as a name for the school, I'm also by training or by dint of my schooling, I majored in poetry. It's a spondee. It's a two accented syllables, one after the other. Proof school. It says what it means. There's no mistaking that it's a good, hard sounding name, and that's where it came from. And the logo. I mean, I came up with the logo just because there's an open halmos, which is a proof symbol, right, with a math circle inside of it, and that then turned into the O for proof, and there you have it.
Thank you. It is a beautiful name. So I would like to thank you, everyone, for the great presentation and for people in the audience for great questions. This is really a promising endeavor that can change things, not just for the kids in the school, but for other communities, for other people. Exciting development, really. So I hope we will all keep in touch, and I hope the greater mathematical community will continue to support and to connect with what you are doing. Now, as we now exit this room and stop the recording, we will have this full conversation recorded, so it can be spread out also to people who couldn't be here today. And let us all keep supporting Proof School and people therein. Thank you very much. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Maria. Thanks, everybody.
Bye, everyone. That was really fun.
Thank you to everybody, and I really hope to meet you all in person as soon as possible.